Use an antibiotic, the underlying This is the most important class if you're going to remember anything from the cell wall of a gram-positive bacteria is much, has a much thicker peptidoglycan layer than this gram-negative, and so you expect that the bactericidal action will be much, much more amplified against these gram-positive bacteria for that reason. So cephalosporins and penicillins, they both bind irreversibly to the penicillin binding proteins to prevent cross-linking. Cellulitis. So let's move on to macrolides. Itself will attach just here, and it inhibits the translocation of growing peptide chain from the A site to the B site. So the mRNA kind of fits in between these two components of the ribosome, the 50S and the 30S, which is specific to bacteria. The mRNA runs through this and it's kind of read off, and it creates this chain. So it blocks what's known as transferase, an enzyme, from catalyzing the attachment of a new amino acid to this growing peptide chain. So it prevents peptide bond being formed on the when the incoming tRNA, which is what's attached to the incoming amino acid, and it prevents the extension of this peptide chain. Basically, it just gets in the way of protein synthesis. You don't need to remember this in any detail, at least exams. It's just good to understand the underlying ways that macrolides work. So, as you can imagine, that is not going to kill bacteria, at least not straight away. It's just going to put a halt on protein synthesis and really slow things down and make things static in the cell. Bacteria static. And resistance against macrolides comes through a mutation which site sort of between this A and B, or on just on the 50S ribosome. So you can imagine if there's a mutation at this binding site, the macrolide can no longer bind, and as a result it can't do its disruptive processes. Okay, so macrolides, their clinical uses. So as I said, they have a very similar antibacterial spectrum to penicillins, and you might be thinking that's strange because they have a very distinct mechanism of action, as I just described. But they do. That's just the way it works. They have very similar spectrum across gram-positive, although they are also active against gram-negatives, as well as some atypical bacteria. But we use them very, very often in conjunction or as a replacement for penicillins due to this similar spectrum and the amount of resistance that is occurring in penicillins and beta-lactams. As a result, we use them very often as an alternative for patients who are either allergic to penicillins — that's a reason to not use penicillins when you might want to — or if their disease or their infection is resistant to penicillin after a
same scenarios.
pieces. So let's get them all up on screen just so that we have everything ready and waiting. Ciprofloxacin, that's one of the quinolones. Just kind of remember the names and how they're used. I suppose that's the best way to think about it. They're routinely used to treat urinary tract infections. It's the drug of choice for treating anthrax, not quite as prevalent these days, thankfully. And some strains are resistant to penicillin, so it's a kind of a good replacement, just like macrolides in that sense. Moxifloxacin is one of a few drugs which is effective in treating tuberculosis. There's only a couple of drugs that are good against tuberculosis, and as such, we kind of keep them reserved for that. It's a very difficult disease to treat. They are first line treatment for patients with keratitis, which is usually caused by Staph aureus or Pseudomonas aeruginosa, and in particular, this anti-pseudomonal activity against Pseudomonas aeruginosa is a really key and important clinical use of quinolones. Pseudomonas aeruginosa
spectrum to which they're Just kind of have the answers there and just to kind of pick one at random. I want us to work specifically, we use it against C. difficile.
negative agent. What class can we rule out based on gram negative? This is the answer. The answer is ciprofloxacin. The answer is ciprofloxacin because that is the only one that has anti-pseudomonal activity, and that's what we should be thinking. We should be thinking Pseudomonas aeruginosa with cystic fibrosis. So that's the answer. The rest are not.